Gildan Media proudly presents Gildan Seminars, original lectures containing essential information that can be applied to every facet of life and business. Gildan Media presents a Gildan Seminar. I Know How to Lose Weight, So Why Can't I Keep It Off? By Nick Hall, written and read by the author.
Mary had always had a problem with her weight. Even in middle school, she was heavier than the other girls, despite being careful about what she ate. Her mother was a registered dietitian, so made sure her daughter had well-balanced and nutritious meals. She was on the swim and track teams for all 4 years of high school, yet Mary still was heavier than she wanted to be. But despite her personal preference for a certain appearance, was she really unhealthy? Probably not. Many children and adults struggle needlessly with their weight. When defining optimal health, one size does not fit all, despite cultural pressure to squeeze everyone into the smallest size possible. Whether monitoring body weight, body mass index, waist-to-hip ratio, or percent body fat, the quest always seems to be for less. Before continuing with this program, ask yourself these three questions to decide if you really need to be worried about your weight. Number one, am I comfortable with my current body weight? Number two, am I in good cardiovascular health? Number three, am I able to maintain the weight acceptable to me without constant dieting? And number four, am I able to do all the things I want to? If your answer to each of those questions is yes, then there's really no need to do anything except use the advice in this program to maintain the status quo. Welcome to I Know How to Lose Weight, So Why Can't I Keep It Off? I'm Dr. Nick Hall. In this program, we'll explore why this question is so common amongst many of us who have struggled with weight issues throughout our lives. And we'll explore the answer to this question with scientific research on exactly why it is that most people cannot keep those extra pounds off. But best of all, I'll give you specific scientifically proven steps that you can take to keep those pounds off and eradicate this question from your consciousness once and for all. Now you may be asking, who is Nick Hall? And why is he qualified to teach me about such an important topic like weight loss? Well, let me give you a bit of my background as it relates to this topic. After spending 2 years researching stress-related communication patterns in whales and dolphins for the Office of Naval Research, I went to graduate school where I completed studies in neuroscience and then postdoctoral training in immunology. I then spent the better part of 30 years researching the chemical pathways linking the brain with the immune system. The field is called psychoneuroimmunology, and over the years, my NIH-funded research ran the gamut from assessing the use of guided imagery in cancer patients to how malnutrition and exercise impact the brain and immune system. I now spend most of my time applying this research with elite athletes and corporate clients at the Saddlebrook Resort Wellness Center near Tampa, Florida, which I happen to direct. I also teach human nutrition at the University of South Florida College of Nursing. Throughout this audiobook, I'll be referring to personal experiences during which I've had the opportunity to apply some of the advice I'll be imparting to you. During part of July and August in 2015, that included a 3,000-mile unsupported solo bicycle ride across the United States to raise money in support of Rotary International's End Polio campaign, During that month-long trek, I was reminded countless times of the ways food can impact sleep and mood, along with strategies to push on despite record-high temperatures in the southwestern states. As a result, the information in this program will be grounded in science, however, tempered with pragmatism, as I explain how you can use a basic understanding of stress and nutrition to not just lose weight, but to keep it off. Once you have listened to this audiobook, hopefully a few times over, it will be time to take action. Adopt the attitude of the British singing sensation Adele Adkins. Adele was cruelly ridiculed by Joan Rivers, who, on the David Letterman show, remarked that Adele should have named her hit song Rolling in the Deep Fried Chicken. That's because, in the eyes of some, Adele didn't conform to the norm. But she saw things from a very different, and I might add, healthy perspective when she was interviewed for the February 2012 edition of People magazine. I've never wanted to look like models on the cover of magazines. I represent the majority of women, and I'm very proud of that, she declared. There's also the matter of the obesity paradox. The research finding published in the medical journal Mayo Clinic Proceedings, revealing that obesity can be correlated with a significant reduction in all-cause mortality. Others showed that an important factor explaining the paradox is the amount of lean body mass compared with fat. This should not be taken as justification to tear up your gym membership and snack on junk food while setting up residence on your couch. The obesity paradox applies to only those individuals who fall into a unique category of having a large amount of lean tissue, which is muscle. For those without this lean tissue, heart disease, musculoskeletal disorders, and type 2 diabetes are just some of the health consequences of carrying excess body weight. I bring this up because losing weight is not a simple matter of dieting or burning excess calories through more exercise. There are many factors involved, including your DNA. Your genetic blueprint sets the stage for everything, including body weight. But genes predict probability, not causality. Having a gene associated with a particular trait is no guarantee you'll acquire it. There are factors capable of activating and deactivating genes. These are known as epigenetic factors. Age and physical characteristics such as bone mass are important as well. But something that is generating a great deal of scientific inquiry is the role of bacteria. No, not the kind that trigger infection. Rather, those that live inside us as part of what is called the microbiome. This emerging research suggests that providing for a healthy mix of beneficial bacteria may also need to be incorporated into a successful weight loss equation. There's one more very important factor that needs to be dealt with: stress. Emotional upheaval can trigger changes in your brain chemistry, driving a craving for carbohydrate and fat-laden foods. That's why the expression emotional eating is used to describe why people under stress may turn to so-called comfort foods. The human brain, despite its enormous complexity, has really just one function: to keep us alive. We approach those things likely to promote our survival and avoid those things that threaten it. Many of the integral processes operate below the conscious radar. For example, we breathe, our heart keeps beating, and critical chemicals are maintained at just the right level, without our conscious awareness of the complex biological machinery operating beneath the skin. But when all the biochemistry is stripped away, the process is really quite straightforward. Each system has a means by which to regulate itself through a system of feedback pathways. When supply is sufficient, production ceases. When more is needed, the assembly line is cranked up. Our behavior is subject to the same basic rules. When we perceive a threat to our well-being, we take steps to avoid the potentially harmful circumstances. In contrast, when circumstances are promoting our well-being, we engage in behaviors to get more. Yes, it's that simple. The brain is essentially an organ that secretes behavior. We approach or we avoid. And we decide which is appropriate depending upon the emotion in place. Positive emotions, such as joy and love, motivate us to seek more, while negative emotions, such as disgust and sadness, motivate us to seek less. This program will explore the start and stop signals that regulate eating behavior. All behavior is governed by the same set of rules. There has to be an initial signal that sets in motion a specific response, which ultimately adjusts the signal. Using the example of eating, the signal is the sensation of hunger. The response is consumption of food, and then, as the stomach fills, messages arrive in the brain to turn the signal off. However, in the interest of efficiency, this otherwise straightforward process can sometimes take a shortcut. Instead of waiting for hunger to arise, other things may acquire the ability to trigger the consumption of food. You may fall into the routine of eating at the same time of day, because that's when lunch is scheduled. Eventually, you eat not because you're hungry, but because the response of eating has become entrained to the time of day. Or you may eat in response to activity. Have you ever visited the zoo shortly before feeding time? If so, you've undoubtedly watched the big cats pace back and forth from one end of their enclosure to the other. The monkeys leapt from one object to another, while the birds flew around their exhibit. Even though the routine included the delivery of food to their cage, they became active prior to the food's arrival in response to other environmental cues. In response to a variety of cues, they ostensibly began to forage for food. Not only do all animals, including humans, become more active before scheduled mealtimes, but there are episodic bursts in the levels of cortisol, the energy-producing steroid which makes sure your tissues have the required fuel to engage in the quest for food. After doing this repeatedly, the activity becomes so closely aligned with eating that it eventually has the ability to replace hunger as a signal to eat. This works in other ways as well. Boredom drives some people to eat as a means by which to offset monotony. Eating becomes the activity the person is seeking to achieve some balance in their life. The result is eating when food is not needed, which results in extra calories which will be stored as fat. It doesn't matter whether those calories are in the form of carbohydrate, fat, or protein. If you don't need them, you will store them. That's why strategies for coping with stress, whether due to anxiety or boredom, must be a part of any weight management strategy. This same basic process of a stimulus leading to a response can also take place well below the conscious radar. Psychoneuroimmunology is the study of how the brain, emotions, and behavior can interface with the immune system, which we need to fight infection and cancer. While the role of emotions in modulating disease has a long and hallowed history, dating to the observations of ancient Greek physicians, it was not until Drs. Robert Ader and Nick Cohen at the University of Rochester demonstrated that the immune system could respond to unrelated cues that the field became the subject of serious scientific inquiry. Those two scientists administered a drug that temporarily reduced the number of disease-fighting white cells in laboratory mice. At the same time, the animals were allowed to taste water flavored with saccharin. Saccharin is an artificial sweetener that does nothing to the immune system. However, after pairing the sweet flavor with the drug, just the taste was capable of reducing the white cell count. That experiment has now been repeated in many clinical contexts, including the study of cancer and autoimmune disease. This groundbreaking experiment launched the field of psychoneuroimmunology. It also affirmed that cues with no direct association with a particular biological system could acquire that ability through an automatic learning process called classical conditioning. This principle had been demonstrated decades earlier when Ivan Pavlov, while studying dogs, triggered salivation by simply ringing a bell, which had previously been paired with the sight and smell of food. A man, obviously searching for something under a street light, was asked by a stranger what he was looking for. "My keys," was the answer. "Is this where you lost them?" the stranger asked. "No, I lost them over there." "Then why aren't you looking over there?" "Because there's more light over here." That's the mistake made by many people attempting to lose weight. They take steps to change the obvious behavior they associate with food. They start with their appetite or hunger signals, which everyone knows are associated with the desire to eat. However, the actual cause of overeating may have no obvious connection to food at all. It may be in the dark regions of your understanding. Overlooking the role of unrelated cues is often the reason sustaining a weight management program can be so difficult. Just about anything has the potential ability to trigger eating as a result of the automatic learning process called classical conditioning. Here's the good news. By definition, those things we do automatically as a result of conditioning can be deconditioned, but only if you know what the trigger is. Once you become consciously aware of what causes the desire to eat, it's a matter of experiencing the trigger, then making sure the normal response does not occur. It may take a lot of willpower, but once you understand why it's important to do so, you'll be far more likely to succeed. Eventually, the urge to eat in response to these conditioned cues will go away. You've succeeded in breaking the unhealthy habit. However, you'll still have to contend with other biological drives, including some occurring deep within your brain. This program will provide you with an understanding of how the brain drives us to seek fat or carbohydrates when those foods are likely to promote survival. It will include a discussion of why stress and the associated emotions is an important cue in stimulating health-destructive eating behavior, as well as ways you can reduce or even stop the desire to eat before it arises. However, the one thing I can't do is provide you with the motivation to change. That is entirely in your hands. What I will do is explain the normal processes of appetite regulation along with the things you can do to take control. In this way, I can instill in you a sense of optimism that you will be successful. What do I want to achieve? Do you want to lose weight? Of course, you might reply. Why else would I have purchased this audiobook? What I really mean is, have you taken the time to reflect upon what is involved? Let's begin that process now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.